that said,
welcome back. You might notice that my NetBeans looks different today. Or I should say my IDE, my integrated development environment. It is the same program, it is still NetBeans. However, I did download a plugin, I forget what it's called. I should have thought to make a note of this prior to installing it. But this is like the Praxis Live look and feel. Search the internet, you can find this. Not entirely sure about the source, but I found this by way of a site which reviews look and feels for the NetBeans IDE application. Some of which had to do with just making some parts of the screen brighter or darker. So I installed that by, well, here's the plugins window. So I dragged and dropped the plugin, the .nbm file, into this window here. Click, checked install, installed it, followed all the license terms and so forth. Didn't make a big deal of it, but in hindsight, that would have been a good thing to record, just for your understanding. The other thing is everywhere that IDE allows you to select a font, it by default selected Monospace. And some time ago, I installed my own font or font set from Liberation Fonts website, which basically has to do with just having good open source fonts and open license fonts out there. So the one I'm choosing instead of Monospace here is Liberation Mono. There are other Liberation fonts, by the way, but I like that these all look beautiful, and to my mind, or to my eye, this looks easier to read than just plain old Monospace. So here's like a portal or a window panel, pick your terms, I don't really care. There it is. Oh, you can actually see a preview here. So this is what monospaced font looks like. You'll notice it's quite condensed. It is probably anti-aliased, so it might actually look better on the stream. I'm not sure. But you compare and contrast this monospaced text with Liberation Mono, and the Liberation font just looks considerably more well-rounded, and I forget what terms you can apply to a font just in terms of its shape, but I've got this at work too. It's just I think it works well with ClearType, which is a technology that's been around for a while. Welcome. So, yeah, just FYI, I changed a few settings from last time. And you're more than welcome, if you have all the software, you can make the similar changes. I don't actually have an explicit agenda for what I'm coding right now. But I'm sure plenty of questions will come to mind pretty quickly, and that's kind of what I was hoping for. I know there are a number of things that I'm confused about how this application works, but, oh, and I still haven't written any unit tests, but I'm not sure I'm at that point where it makes sense to do that. So just as a reminder, you can run the program. This brings up Jago, Java Go client. This is still technically 6.2 plus whatever I've changed on it. Then you can use this to connect to an ICS Go server. So I've installed one on my PC. Here it is. I've already logged in with my username and password. And we can get a listing of what games are in progress. can get a listing of just who's online and so on and so forth. I don't like this word error. Well, I guess maybe the purpose of, maybe there's just a general purpose error logging mechanism, and this who dialog might use it to it just report back that there's nobody that matches, as opposed to displaying an empty grid or something sane, in my opinion. My logging still works, so that's fortunate. So I'm gonna delve in and do some coding, and some people enjoy watching this, so that's why I'm streaming it. Raises so many questions. Even this one little snippet of code, which sends a datagram message to an address and to a port at that address. This just seems so incredibly flimsy. But I don't care about that at the moment. I can always change that later. That can be treated as a different aspect from everything else in this application. So I can leave that be, even though it doesn't really abide by any external standard. It kind of invents its own. Let's see. Is there anything that just looks tricky or... like, you see the IDE will point out warnings. Like, you should never leak a reference to a not yet constructed object, because what if the construction fails? Then you leaked a bad reference. So this is just stuff you should not do, and that's done. Calling methods which are capable of being overridden within the context of a constructor is bad for the same reason, although to a lesser extent. So here we have a object call or class called ColorEdit, or in this case this has color scroll bar and then later has color edit. If somebody came up with a my color scroll bar or a striped colored scroll bar or something ridiculous like that, they could override these methods like set layout and add. And that would require calling the overridden implementation just per how Java works. So there's some things that are done here that don't really conform to best practices, although they aren't that terrible. Also here, set layout. That's not how you want to do this. One thing of note, if you don't explicitly call a constructor, Java will call super on your behalf, because you do have to construct your super class before you can construct the subclass. I won't bore you with the details. It's pretty boring. Most constructors allow you to take parameters, like a layout manager. So instead of calling empty constructor and then later calling set layout, do it this way. Pass the layout manager into the constructor. I'm kind of confused. How does this... Yeah, this does call an overridable method. And it is public. So why aren't there warnings here? I don't know. Somehow when other people's code does it, it's okay. I was expecting something else there, frankly. But we'll make do with that. I similarly here, if you're going to construct a panel and you know what layout manager you're going to use, in most cases you're able to just do that. Oh, wait, does my panel not extend something? Yeah, it does. Just doesn't extend, and then call that. Yeah, layout manager is the correct one of these. I thought that there were multiple layout managers listed there. So, okay. This is ridiculous, but I mean, okay, fine. Do I need to implement any other constructors? What other constructors are there? There's layout manager and then is double buffered. You know, just for completeness sake, let's do all four. Okay. Just so there's no possibility of forgetting something. Alright, there we go. Yeah, there's tons of code redundancy. What can you do? Well, you could have all your constructors fan into each other, but whatever. At this point, it's just not worth it. It would be better. How far and wide is this panel thing used? Oh, it's used all over the place. Never mind. I was going to say it would be better to create something that constructs this and then sets its background. But, you know, this is pretty convenient coding-wise. I guess just based on how many times this is used, and it's perfectly fine and acceptable and good to do it this way. It just looks pretty hokey. There's no logger declared, but is really that the most troubling aspect of this, or are there other warnings? Oh, we're missing Javadoc. Yep, let's create that. This packaged also, well, where's global package? Global is, this is well, this is a client thing. Not user configurations, application color configuration. Application doesn't really add much there, so I'm just going to say this. And if adding class there also doesn't really add much in terms of explanation, so there we go. Okay, this makes me understand a bit better, at least in terms of compiler warnings, why most initializers that construct panels, why they're called like init, and they're private and void. purpose of that, at least in terms of avoiding compiler warnings, is that you can call a private method, like init, and then that private method can call just about anything, and the compiler won't warn you about that. But here we are trying to call add within a constructor, and it's kind of a mess, because what if we perform this add and then we encounter some kind of weird runtime exception trying to create a new scroll bar, and so we fail to create this color scroll bar? That's just kind of a problem. Also, why is color scroll bar extending panel? That seems weird. Why would you do that instead of, well, I guess we're adding a label, so we have to fit the label and the scroll bar into the color scroll bar panel. But why would you call this a scroll bar if it's a panel? Scroll bar has a pretty specific concept in Windows and most OSs, and it's just misleading to call this a scroll bar when it's actually a panel. But it's not causing any problems, it's just confusing. And adjustment listener. Oh, yeah, this is another thing I would probably move out of the constructor. And want to reserve until after we perform the construction. Because if this fails with a runtime exception, not that it will, but also that we're leaking this in the constructor. Come to think of it, I've seen plenty of precedents for doing that. But it's still sloppy. I suppose I'll have to make do with the way it is until I come up with a better paradigm. Don't need to wrap this. Monitors are pretty wide these days. There's no need to be so afraid of column 80, which you see there is the little thin blue line. There's no need to wrap just to avoid the blue line. A lot of the code that's here does that, and it's just unnecessary. Let's grab this. We're gonna want to where'd it go? My panel. And we wanted to make a reference to Java Go client dialogues color edit, which sets up all those color configuration settings. No reason not to make that cross-reference. Well, it's not a cross-reference, but it's a reference. Let's see, function key edit. And nothing stands out as being blatantly wrong here. Other than why do you have this defined? I mean, it seems like a pretty weird thing to define, am I right? Extends gray text field and implements, has a way of saying for an int, get the parameter setting for the int. But, yeah, I just don't get it. I'm guessing this is used all over the place, and I'm just going to be sad because replacing things that are of that nature is tricky. No. Okay, so there are 10 function keys. And oh wow. So yeah, no, I don't really like this at all. So instead of calling this a function key, I'm gonna call it what it should be, which is great text field. Up the appropriate setting right then and there. And dispose of this one line class, which doesn't need to be there, which of course is going to cause compilation errors over here. So you got to deal with that. Now, I'm not really big on the idea of an array of components either. Why would you have any need to make an array like that? There is no need. There's no need to retain a reference to the component that way. So let's get rid of said declaration. There we go. Code's easier to read, easier to understand, because we don't really need to keep cache away that reference, as far as I see. And of course I'm wrong, that there is a use of that. Let's see, for that loop, fki get text. Well, okay, I guess I gotta restore that. Oh, this actually needs the integer index as well. Why would you define something so fragile? Set parameter f number equal to the text of that function key, I guess. That's so weird to me. I don't understand why you do that. Because that just undoes this up here. Literally, those are the opposites of each other. There's which happened first, the chicken or the egg? I don't know, but does it really matter? But I see this is all followed by the word disposed. Oh, so, and this class is called function key edit. So this edits function keys. And I guess do action must be called upon being done with this window, or having a need to save its values. I guess when you save, you're also done. So I'm being redundant here. Dun dun dun. Let's use the word done a lot. So this initially populates the window with the parameters, and then you can change what those function keys do somehow through the window or the dialog or what have you. And then when you're done, do action somehow gets called and takes the text inside each one of those function keys and stores it away in some kind of parameter thing. But is really there no way to, I mean, here we can set a label and then create a gray text field. What bothers me is this right here. The fact that we've got to iterate through these components to redefine their parameter keys. Those keys should be established by the time we've finished this loop. They shouldn't need to be reestablished down here. One second, I gotta take a quick break here. Set the mic. Okay, we're back. So what do we got? Yeah, so although that's troubling, I'll just let it be. There's really not much I can do at this point. Or at least there is stuff I could do, but the effort it would take me to expend to get things done doesn't justify doing it at this time. This sort of thing's also kind of disturbing. We should not be overriding methods without a really good reason. But okay, we'll leave that be. Get parameter. Oh, I remember I added this generic type bound here so that we were able to reuse that parameter in multiple places. I don't think anything else seriously jumped out as wrong at that time. So that's probably fine. Let's skip over the help content because I'm not too concerned about making that work right now. I don't like the fact that message calls set visible. Where is this called from? And do those contexts already? Okay, well, that's manageable. I was afraid that that, for a second, might not be manageable. But yeah, this should say new message dot set visible true. The constructor should not be responsible for making something visible. Because... I guess within the context of the constructor, that's fine, but there's no way that the calling context can have the expectation, at least for new developers, there's no way a new developer can just look at the code and expect that something's going to be displayed there. So, in the name of referential transparency, we construct a new thing and then make that new thing visible, as opposed to having the construction itself, if construction is successful, display something. Apparently, I've at least in one place taken at least a couple places here have gone through the pains of doing it the right way. But yeah, you see all kinds of compiler warnings saying, okay, great, you're constructing a new object, but just there's no evidence that you're actually doing anything with said object. I see plenty of Pokemon exception handling here, where we're just catching everything and perhaps doing it prematurely. Which at some point might be worth cleaning up. It's a pretty common coding anti-pattern to catch things all over the place because you don't like the possibility that an exception might leak somewhere. But, right, so we don't need to say message D equals new message, we just need to say, take that new message and display it, set visible true on it. There's no need to retain a reference to something we're not going to use. Pity this is such a manual effort. I haven't thought of a better way to do this sort of thing. There's always trial and error where you just take out the code that's causing the initial warning, and then if code doesn't produce the expected result, then go in and start adding code that makes it work. In some contexts, that could be a useful strategy. Like, if you have a block of code that's just truly indecipherable, and you lack any kind of testing tools, sometimes it does make sense to break something deliberately, and then only fix it under a context where you know or understand that it needs fixing. And just leave it broken in those other contexts. Make it fail fast. That's certainly something that in some contexts makes sense. This is more references than I expected. Sorry to bore you with all this. This definitely screams that if we're constructing something all over the place, there must be a better way to do it than say new message, new message, new message all over the place. You could probably have one generic message exception or some kind of exception that's thrown and make the single catcher of that kind of exception. Make that single catcher just construct a message dialogue and make it visible. This kind of coding pattern. It's also kind of an argument against Java. Java requires you to be really verbose about what you're doing if you're going to make it referentially transparent. And so there's some laziness sometimes, or perhaps just people feel that it's best to code things in the more compact fashion. They would rather have a single line of code here, set visible true, than make every consumer of this call set visible. But in my mind, the referential transparency outweighs the code efficiency, but some people come up with their own standards. I guess I'm neglecting the fact that my standard about referential transparency is my own standard, but I think it's a good thing. Yeah, sorry, I don't have more of a leg to stand on there. Yeah, again, leaking this in the constructor is not a very good thing. So ideally, whatever called this should call global set window with a reference to this, as opposed to making this constructor call it. Or there should be a utility method. That's actually the more reasonable thing. It says construct a message, which not only calls set visible true, but also calls whatever has to be called to make this work. This set window, I mean, global's a class, so this must be a static method, right? Yeah. So you could have like a static create instance method here in message, which is probably what I should have been doing. But again, I like the idea of code being transparent or referentially transparent. So what I did was okay. It might not have been the best way, but at least now all those times we're calling new object, now it's clear that we're calling new object and also what are we doing? Also, we're making that object visible. So there's no surprises there. The only surprises to that consumer of this message thing is that message now also registers itself with something in this global class. I'm not really sure what or why. What's the point of said registration? I don't get it. Wait, do we have any need for this beyond knowing that it's a window? Not really. Do a whole bunch of static things, or we do a whole bunch of generic window activities on it, like pack all the components to make it fit really tightly and nicely, and call set bounds for some reason. I guess because we have preferences as to where this last appeared and where we'd like it to appear in the future. So many warnings in this file. I mean, I get that hash table is obsolete, that I understand. field hides another field, I'll leave that be. Window list. Window list equals new hash table. What are the contents of this hash table? Wait. So we construct this, but do we need to do anything after its construction? Normally I'm able to just do a find or a text search to see like what's using it, but no, that's just empty. Meaning we don't even need it. Nothing's using it. Nothing's gonna miss it being gone. This is just a set of preferences. This doesn't actually keep a listing of all the windows. And I'm not seeing a reason that it would need to. Wait, is this still the bundle name? I18N. Is this under resources? I18N. Java resource properties. Yeah, it's still what it's called. If B is equal to null. This is a static construction, so B is always going to be equal to null here. Unless something really weird happened. Where's B declared? I'm not seeing B's declaration. Let's scroll down. Oh, it's declared way down here, just to make things confusing. Okay. I see. So the first time we need B, it gets... well, it doesn't get constructed the first time it's needed. It gets constructed statically, just as the constructor progresses. Static construction progresses. And we have a global which extends another global. Really wouldn't have killed somebody to differentiate between these two. But fine. Oh, is there anything declared up here that's going to make me cringe? Are there any instance references that don't need to be here? Not seeing a whole lot of variable declarations. I guess I could skim through this. So we have a whole bunch of methods. We got some variables declared. Like these fonts, which are initially set to null. And then when make fonts is statically... Why? Okay. What use is this? It's only used in one place right now. Static methods can't be overridden anyway. There's really no reason to separate this out. Other than some future intent to say, oh yeah, we're totally going to construct this later. And replace the values of these... I mean, maybe that's the point, is that this can be called more than once, or this is not reentrant, it's just called a single time. That I actually buy. Let's see, what other things? There's patterns. Oh, I define those. Those are cool. Use this for text matching instead of writing your own text matching code. People talk poorly about regular expressions. They can, in some cases, make your life difficult, but they are definitely meant for text parsing. If you're looking for text that's structured in a regular fashion, then use a regular text pattern, or I guess a regular expression to spell out what you're looking for. If you've got really well-formatted regular text, this is the way to go. Only because Java doesn't have a way of saying look for an integer or look for a color code thing. Like here we're saying look for look for two digits, two hexadecimal digits, and look for three blocks of two hexadecimal digits in sequence. And these are going to be the red, green, and blue values, and they have to be preceded with a octothorpe. So what else is here? There's P and F. P is a properties object. F is a frame. I'm not so keen on F just being a plain old frame. It'd be useful if F were some sort of generic thing that could be a frame, but could also be a more... Wait, public static frame F. Static frame F. Why would you do this? You do this just to make people cry. Why would you shadow parameters like that? Okay, how far and wide is this F used? Okay. What type of frame is this? We are talking about the same frame type, right? Okay, fine, I've got to drill down into this. This is a Java AWT frame, right? There's the package declaration, Java AWT frame. Is this also Java AWT frame? Yes. So, why would you do this? Why the separation? Does this have a method called frame that also returns the frame object? I guess not. Though I can't imagine why not. Okay. Does anybody call this, which sets the static frame object? Okay, yeah, this is called. Where is this used? F equals new frame. So, when we want to put up a warning. Wait, how does this work? Is warning a composition of the frame? Or is warning something other than the frame? It's a dialogue. That dialogue accepts a frame. That frame is F. What do we do with F? I'm assuming that's a different window. You call new dialogue F, info dialogue. I'm guessing that nothing is done with the value of this reference. Other than we just retain the value of that. Okay. G.center F. Center. Probably says put this in the center of the screen with regard to that frame. Yes. That's exactly what it does. However, there's already a method for doing that. Actually, hang on. Instead of doing this, this is what should be done. Don't need any of that. So deprecate that stuff. Yeah, we don't want to have our own centering logic, because some platforms won't want to center a window on top of another window. Some platforms will want to, based on the sizes of your windows, it might make sense for the pop-up dialog that appears on top of your application window to appear off-center. If your pop-up dialog happens to be much larger than your application and your application's in the corner of the screen. And I'm sure this handles at least some of those cases. But, yeah, let's be real. There's no reason to write your own version of library functions. It's just sad. Okay, but yeah, my point is that this F here, the only reason there's any reference that's copied all over the place is such that when dialogues are displayed, they're centered or located relative to that F. That said, this stuff doesn't really belong in the descendant class. This belongs in the ancestor. And this doesn't belong here either. go over here where that's declared. And in that same general context, declare these methods. Now, what's... Oh, well, yeah, it's complaining about the Java doc, or lack thereof. I don't fault it for that. We are definitely lacking in Java doc. But, oh, this class actually... Fine. This class actually does proper Java doc, so I will be bothered to add missing things. There we go. Instead of calling this an invisible, well, I don't know. Set a default. Let's say application. Well, applications are reused. Mainframe is misnomer. Set the application window. This should take an imperative form. There we go. And we'll say gets the application window. Except it doesn't have a parameter of type F. It instead returns a frame. Now, you'll notice I've been using the word window. I would actually prefer to use the word window here as well, but as you saw, there's code all over the darn place that that expects F to be of a type frame rather than of type window. So changing that's not going to be anything simple to do. It's worthwhile doing, because somebody might construct, I don't know how they do it, but they might. I construct a application that's just a dialog rather than a window, or I'm sorry, a dialog rather than a frame. Practice, eh? Not entirely sure what you're talking about, but welcome anyhow. So where was I? Are there any other references to this F thing up here? Oh, there's other variables by the name of F. By the way, that's why you don't write variable names that are a single letter. It's just sad. Don't do it. Init bundle. Why is it doing this? Why do we check the value of F between executions? Okay, I don't even know. That makes no sense. Wait, oh, I'm sorry, this is checking the value of B, not of F. Okay. Let's see, I'm guessing init bundle sets the value of that. Here it is, trying to assign that to B. If there's an exception, we set B to null. But that's not how you should do this. You should instead... what's the type of B? It's a resource bundle. Oh, I was going to say, surely this extends something called a resource or bundle or something like that, but no. This is the interface type. So, what we should do, let's see, usage of static non-final, oh, yeah, that's also a problem. Oh, bad practice. Yeah, there's a lot of poor practices in this code. I'm cleaning it up so that I can be in a state where I can do more with this application. And this is a client for an internet Go server. So you can, I think it's still in the running state, or a state where it can be run. So this brings up a window. And then I say I want to connect to my server, and I'm connected to the server, and I can see things like who's logged in, what games are in progress, and stuff like that. So I'm borrowing this code, and cleaning it up before I make any more changes to it. Yeah. I'm impressed by what the original author did. Otherwise, I'd start from scratch. Oh, my volume's too low. I'll show you here. My mic is completely maxed out. There's nothing I can do about the volume at this point, other than try to wake up a little bit more and shout into the microphone. Or move it around. But that's going to make all kinds of noises if I move it. Let me try moving it. Sorry. That might work slightly better, but I don't think it's going to make a big difference. But yeah, I was saying here, actually wait, this bundle doesn't exist in that context, right? So we've got resources, I18N, Jago resource. So this attempt to just, based on my rewriting of some code, this second call makes no sense whatsoever. That first call better work. And it will. I mean, let me test. You see that here I can do things like invoke the help window wherever that's at. And I think at least some of these are based on the cached resources. I could be wrong. And yeah, it's freeware under the GNU GPL. I did ask the author's permission to go ahead and make this redistributable, even though technically, since it's GPL licensed, I don't need that permission anyway. I18N means internationalization, but people are so accustomed to mistyping that, that it's always abbreviated to I18N. Like, there's like L11N for localization, other abbreviations that just prevent flagrant typos from breaking your project forever. But yeah, you see here, like, there's the English mapping of parameters, I guess this is a parameter map, or a property map. You have all these property keys and property values. And then we got that for those who know German. Here's all the keys, here's all the values. I mean, yeah, frequently this internationalization stuff is used for translation. I mean, that's the key point of it. But there might be other settings as to like what currency you use or whether you do things in imperial or metric. You don't get the use of property files. I don't know what you're saying. Why would you not use a property file? Would you rather keep those properties in a registry, or where else would you keep them? Property files allow you to divorce your code from your settings, which is really useful. Yeah, of course, you have to have something capable of reading the file, but you don't want to embed your settings into your source code. I know some people who do that, and it's a big pain. You don't want to do that. as much as you might think you might want to. Wait. Why would anybody do it this way? Object G equals new global object. Return g.getClass.getResources stream. Good gravy, why? First of all, don't call things global object. Second, in order to get a reference to the class, you don't actually need to construct the object itself. You could say global object.class.getResourcesStream. So what was this person trying to do? Oh, that's it. That's the entire global object. Okay. Yeah, no, I don't respect that at all. That's gone. And we can say instead return global dot class. Because we know global's a valid class at this point, right? If we've already constructed a global, or I mean, this shouldn't be instantiable. This should be abstract. And that's not going to break anything, of course. And going up here, this global is also not intended to be constructed. Or instantiated. It still encounters or goes through class construction, but it doesn't need, you don't need to be able to construct instances of it. Yes, that works. But by the time we reach that point in the code, that point being over here, we've already constructed the class. I mean, we've tried to resolve URLs, and this method exists. All the parameters, not parameters, all the attributes of the class that are statically defined, because obviously there's no instances, they're just class attributes or members. Those members already are defined. These methods are defined. So of course, this should resolve just fine. I mean, yeah, there's a lot of this source code which is headache inducing. A lot of the author saying, I'm gonna do it my way. And to their credit, they got an application which runs on like every version of Java and every OS. But, you know, it's great that they did all that, but they didn't really have the thinking that they need to be able to extend this in the future. One sec. That there's to remind me to wake up and that I need to have breakfast and go to work. But we've got some time here. So let's enjoy our remaining time. No, I'm just coding at this point, not really doing much in the way of testing. Did some testing yesterday, found that I haven't broken or fixed anything too significant lately. Although the code keeps getting more and more compact and compliant with standards. Like this sort of thing, it drives me crazy. Lang.length is greater than 3 and lang.char2 is equal to underscore. Yeah, okay, I know what you're trying to say, at least I think I do. That you're checking for the presence of a language. And seeing if that language it has to have more than 3 characters, and the third character has to be an underscore. I'm not sure why you would do that. That seems horribly painful, but, you know, fine. But I've already established that this isn't going to work. All these places where we're calling the bundle and then get resource, we don't need a second call. Well, I guess there's just 2 places. So let me refresh this. Yeah. So we're always going to get the resources out of the i18n resource bundle file URL path. I'm not getting the nomenclature there right, but you know that I'm trying to say is that we're going to look on the class path and find it in the same place every time, and it's never going to be in that other place. I think the point, though, of that second call was that if somehow this bundle failed to be found, and it won't fail to be found, but if somehow it did, you could look on disk somewhere to try to find it elsewhere. But it's not going to break. Like, I can run this, and we see that I still have all the messages, like I have text on these connect and edit and add and server connections, partner connections, and all that. So, I could also change the source code here, right? So I could say, well, I dare not because I know not how to undo the change, but I could like say DE underscore and then sudden, well, DE underscore something. I'm not sure exactly how that would work. But yeah, then I'd be able to get all the German translations on all the buttons and stuff. What I worry isn't about this executing something weird, but about later when I go to close the program that it might try to save the fact that I'm doing everything in German. And I don't know how to undo that right now. Wait. String file Boolean language. So you're telling me that there are some things that, in fact, by default, this is... Okay, I don't understand you. No, that just completely defies explanation. Init bundle is passed at this being. I just don't understand this at all anymore. Why would you do it this way? Why would you define a two argument method and then only call it with the second value equal to false? I know I did just get rid of some calls here, but like they fan in through the same thing. And why would false be the default value? There's rhyme and reason for a lot of things, but yeah, it's beyond me why you would do it this way. Yeah, it's a good exercise, and sometimes there are good reasons. Like this sort of thing also is troubling. Why would you catch runtime exception here? Is there anything so terrible about allowing runtime exception to percolate from this method boundary outside of itself? Like, if something programmatically is wrong, shouldn't we at least log something here saying that you failed? Well, I guess this is maybe correlated with the other thing we're saying. Sometimes we might not get, we might not be successful in obtaining the bundle. I'm going to remove this try-catch, which is just paranoid code. And if there is a problem, we'll observe that problem in far greater detail. But there won't be. Code will work just fine. See? No errors logged. Code's flawless. But no, if there actually were an error, it would fail fast, and then we could change whatever's invoking this to catch the appropriate error or exception type. Jeez. I still don't understand why OY, would you have a two argument method, and then the second argument would always be called with the value false? Why not just make a one argument method and define this parameter up here, Boolean language equals false, and then have the compiler warn you that, oh, by the way, every time you call this, you're always going to skip by this branch. It just seems silly. Also, why would you bother to get this parameter if language is not equal to true? I know there's some value in having code that doesn't expand way off to the right. But no, this is how I would write it. I'd write it like that. There's no need to check your language if you've already pre-decided that you're not going to be doing any of that. Why even bother getting the language setting if you already know that you're not going to do that? Also, language is an awfully terrible name for a parameter. Yeah, I know that everything in Java is a noun. Every object's a noun. Every method name's a verb of some sort. But configuration sorts of objects take on more adjective-y sorts of nature. So you don't call it language. Nobody knows what language means. Now, if this were string language and that were the actual language you wanted to translate into, that'd be one thing. But what you're saying here is not language, but if we want to translate, or I'm sorry, not translate, we want to localize. Only then do we bother with this locale stuff. Yeah, well, it's really easy to write paranoid code because people are adverse to anything ever going wrong. My coding philosophy here is things go wrong. That's unavoidable. All you can do is just write better tests and do better testing. But yeah, things will go wrong, and rather than just assume that by trying to sweep things under the rug and hide them that there's nothing to ever worry about, make things referentially transparent, bring them out in the light of day, and deal with them like adults. Also, yeah, if you're gonna say, if you're gonna have this kind of check, like, get parameter here, oh, wait, no, okay, this calls get property result equals result substring 1, so it gets rid of the leading dollar sign, fine. I don't like that either, but it's fine. I was going to say, why would your default value be an empty string if, say, we're using this property interface, and I think the default, if the property is not found, or if the property is, I don't know, if the property is empty, I'm not sure what an empty string versus a null value are worth. Because we've seen that these come out of property files, right? And so there is a standard, whether or not we understand it. But say you have a property like this here, where it's just help suffix equals, and there's no value defined there. I think that gets translated as null. And if that gets translated as null or blank or whatever, then the default value should be used instead of an empty string. So if we're calling get parameter and then checking is my parameter name equal to blank or is it equal to default? Why wouldn't you just make default the default here? I guess we still need this check, unfortunately, because get parameter does this special thing here where it says if your value starts with a dollar sign, remove that dollar sign at the beginning. Fine, I guess that's okay, but it kind of changes the concept of a default value here. Now, is anybody ever going to define, like, my language is equal to dollar sign? Probably not. It's probably okay to say, you know what, my default language is not going to be blank, it's going to be default. And then I'm going to check not is lang. Well, it's actually fine, because we're never going to have a null value here. Just say that, right? Simple code. Also, there's no need to make names like lang. We can call things what they are. Lang sec. What's a lang sec? I don't know. Oh, what's this? Oh, country code. Okay, fine. See? That wasn't so hard. New locale with language and country. Just call things what they are. Don't come up with your own cutesy names for it, because eventually it gets confusing. Speaking of money, yeah, that's a fun thing. Yeah, there are comments in the code sometimes, which is a good thing. Also, the code is in a good enough state. It was relatively well structured. It might be over-engineered, there might be tons of flaws in it, but its fundamental, like, structuring or API made some sense to me. So there's a lot of value to the way this is written, and the fact that it works pretty well. And so that inspired me, rather than just go it alone and write my own and figure out what all the server commands and all the timer, whatever things, the BoYoMi and how all that Comey counting works. I'm leveraging an existing application and just making it better. Still using the standards that are there. String country equals blank. Now what happens, how many constructors are there of locale? In fact, I could just go here to find that. So there's language, language and country, language, country, and variant. So what happens, I want to see what does new locale of language invoke, because I'm just curious. So this passes an empty string. So the fact that this is by default an empty string rather than null is okay. Everything's fine. Still a better way, a cleaner way to do this. I don't know whether I should bother. Yeah, no, we're gonna do it. Pattern equals pattern.compile. This sort of well-structured text is meant for a regular expression. So we're going to have two letters, an underscore, and more letters to follow. Yeah, underscore is itself a literal character and not some kind of special meta character, so that should work. Now we can say if Actually, wait. Matcher. Matcher equals pattern dot matcher of language. If matcher not equals, if this matches, only then do we say country equals language, or sorry, equals match or group number two in the regular expression, and language equals matcher group one. So that's how you do regular expressions. Thought you're writing a client, that's me. I was writing a client even for a single class. So this project did you just floodlight? Yeah. You don't want to write Java code manually that does form layout management. You want to use a form editor. I think NetBeans has one called Matisse. But if you're doing some really complicated things, maybe Matisse doesn't work for you. I don't know. Yeah, Java's quite popular because it runs on a lot of devices, but I question the need to be able to run a program on so many devices. But this is popular because it is cross-platform compatible. It's just a pain in the butt to install it and run it. Matisse is pretty infinitely flexible. Although, I think since then, and this is what really makes me kind of question what's going on there, there's the ability to construct JavaFX and JavaFX2 applications. And really, Oracle's been pushing that pretty hard. And the Java community's pushing back and saying, whoa, why am I changing how I write my applications? And Oracle's taken a lot of steps to say, oh wait, no, now we're going to allow you to embed your old screens and components and so forth into these JavaFX containers. And you could even do vice versa, embedding JavaFX componentry into Java Swing applications. But yeah, I mean, Oracle is what it is. They own Java at this point, although the Java community doesn't like that. I don't like it. But they own it. They're gonna push it in a certain direction until either it's successful or it goes off a cliff, and loyal Java adherents will still be coding in this way with AWT and Swing because they don't want to follow it off the cliff. But you know, I don't know, there's a lot of merit to what they're trying to do. I just don't know how successful they are with it. Because nobody's taking them seriously because it's something new. And it's a chicken and the egg sort of problem that it's just not going to work. It's not going to become popular until somebody makes it popular. And because it's not popular, people aren't going to be using it. So there's kind of a mess there. But no, I like the spirit of what they're trying to do with JavaFX, to say that AWT was made back in the 90s or earlier. It's got so many problems that are so difficult to address that you really don't want to be writing AWT or Swing, which extends AWT applications. You don't want to be doing that anymore. you want to be using a modern language. And then they have to convince you that JavaFX is the modern language you want to be using. But I think they made some good effort with it. I just haven't found a way to be able to use it for my own needs. And that's outside of the context of this silly game. Games are fun, but yeah, for actual work, I don't know. I like JavaFX, but it's difficult to convince anybody that it's going to fulfill all the business purposes that existing technologies already fulfill. It's really difficult to... I mean, if you're starting anew, if you were able to start completely from scratch, FX might make some sense. You'd have to experiment and see if it works. And there really isn't the kind of support community for that there is for older languages like AWT and Swing and other extensions of AWT. Like, I want to say, like, even GWT has some support, although good luck. I've tried using it. It's fun stuff, really. Yeah, I don't know much about JavaScript. I deliberately avoid understanding it. At least until I have to try to understand it to get something done. Then I get the thing done, and then I forget everything I knew about it. Because I don't want to be a JavaScript expert. People are going to ask you all kinds of questions, and JavaScript's just a bad language. It's portable. It works on every browser except when it doesn't work. And it's just lacking any focus. Yeah, it's evolving standard. But the minute that a new standard is published, Microsoft decides to do things their own way, Google decides to do things their own way, every browser has their own nuances which improve upon the language, and it's just completely maddening. And even things which are supposed to work aren't compatible across all browsers. I mean, there's no way that all browsers are going to be able to support every last nuance of something. Also, why... there's a better way to do this. I forget if it's in the constructor properties itself. How do I get properties out of this thing? I know there's a better way to get properties. Although maybe I'm thinking of doing it from the file system as opposed to doing it this way. But yeah, this is another case where they're using the wrong mechanism. You want to say try, declare your resource bundle, and then define your catch clause here. And this should not be just a vanilla exception, but it should be IO exception that could potentially fail. I just forget the right way to do it. But this is where I'm talking about, like, Java Swing has such great support. Java properties. File try with resources. What's the recipe? I forget. That's not it. Find Java properties class, file stuff, essential classes. I'm guessing this is just the raw API. It's probably not going to tell me how to use it. That's not the point of this API, but there's documentation here. What's the best way to get properties out of a file? Yeah, you define a file input stream and then you load it. This isn't a Okay, so I'm sorry. When it says string file name, it took that literally to assume that that meant that this is a file. G.get class is unnecessary here. We can say global.class. We don't need a new object. And we don't need to call close because there we go. Load throws IO exception. Basically, the only exception we can encounter in this context is IO exception, so that's the one we should be catching. Other exceptions won't happen in this context. Now, this example does say construct a new properties instance and then load, so that's fine. And there's like no way to do it without that. Furthermore, let's get rid of the code duplication here and say p.remove, p.clear. Yeah, clear removes all the entries from, wait, p is a hash table? No, it's a properties object. I did not know that properties extended hash table, but fine. I mean, it makes sense, but just seeing it's interesting. He closed the inn in the try block. I assume you're referring to whatever used to be here. Yeah, but I'm just saying it's not necessary to call close anymore because we're doing try with resources, which automatically closes things when they're no longer referenced. So the way that this used to read is that it would call in.close if you got to that line of the code. But if you didn't get to that line of the code and some exception happened, you'd get down here and in would never get closed. That's the point of doing this sort of thing, is that now it'll automatically close. Even if exceptions or errors or whatever happen, it's still going to close the resource. So, config name equals file name. I don't understand the nuance there either. Oh, hey, look. Hey, look, look, look. It's the same thing. Isn't that great? Getting it from resource, we're instead getting it from the files. Wait, was the setting p to null? No, this is saying p to a new instance in event of failure. So let's make that the first thing we do. And then say down here, p.clear. Return true, return false, whatever. Separate that. Fine. Whatever. There we go. Predictable code. Easy to read, easy to predict what's going to happen, and if a true or a false got returned, we know under what circumstance. But yeah, having that tail return true is also acceptable. It's perfectly fine, I just don't care for it. Well, I do have to wrap this up. This has been a lot of fun. Let's give this one last whirl. Hey, look, it comes up. Hey, look, it comes up. Hey, I can hit the buttons, stuff happens. Yay. Perfect. Everything we ever hoped and dreamed for. So yeah, thanks for watching. It's been fun. I was wondering why this didn't automatically close. I could always go here and close it, right? And then, yeah, we see this is terminated, so cool. All right, and I should conclude this with committing my changes and just a demonstration how that works. I do have to go pretty soon, but let's get this out of the way first. Git, show changes, diff. So I changed a few things. I changed how we use properties, or how we fetch the properties. That's really not an important... Compared to the other things we changed, it's really not much of note. So I changed all these things to call setVisibleTrue. I wish I'd been committing as I went along, as opposed to having to do one big commit at the end. Shame on me. That's okay. I think the key thing I ended up changing here was just how Global ends up using its resources, and how it uses, in particular, this frame F, now consistently with how its ancestor class also uses frame F. So two things I changed here today were, simplify use of global what does it mean to make one class more consistent with another by way of, I guess, reduce is a key word here. Reduce global into ancestor class. And reduce global into ancestor. And the other thing was changing how we're calling set visible all place. And make message dialogues visible. Something like that. That's probably fine. So commit that. That's all well and good. And then we say git remote pushed upstream. And here we go. Successfully pushed. Don't know why it says forced. That seems a bit of a mislabel to me, but hey, now the change is available. So if you look for this Django client, I don't know why you would. This is still very experimental at this point. I should probably update the description on that to say that it's an experimental Java 8 client, because I'm not intending to support anything less than Java 8. But yeah, it's good fun. Hopefully this will get to a point eventually. Just coding, there's so much to do, but hopefully it'll get to a point where I'm actually introducing new features and puzzles and AI and other stuff, but I'm not there yet. Yeah, I'm just giving it away. Some people believe in their ability to develop the code, and furthermore, I'm compelled to give it away because it's GPL It's GNU public license. So as long as I'm still using this and not building my own from scratch, I have to give it away. But I think it also makes sense to just freely give it. There's all kinds of models, and selling software is an extremely difficult and complex model for somebody who's not a professional in that sort of thing. So, yeah, I'm not opting to sell it. I'm not taking the approach some other developers take. Doesn't mean I can't make my own server, like inject ads or ask for donations or whatever, but I'm not going to try to sell the software itself. Selling software is a lot more challenging than asking for donations. In particular, figuring out the right way to DRM it, it's just a mess. So, plus, once you have DRM'd it, then and you are trying to sell it, you have to make an effort. Oh, what's it? You have to make an effort to promote the material and make people want to buy it. It's just asking for donations makes a lot more sense for a new developer than trying to self-publish. So, that's my perspective so far. Plus, my motivation here is that eventually I do want it just to be really functional and like have AI stuff working. This is more of a hobby than me trying to profit off of it, because if I wanted to profit from writing code, I could do that, and I do that, and I don't need to do this sort of thing. But it'd be nice to make a living doing this sort of thing. This could be fun. By this, I don't mean rewriting the application, but I mean all the fun stuff I intend to later do with it, but whatever. So anyhow, it's been a fun session. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you around.